Thanks for coming. We'll begin with a little commercial spiel, because CUNY Forum is the first in CUNY's 150-year history to focus on Asian and Asian Americans, but it follows a long tradition of East Coast publications like Bridge and Amerasia Journal, which was also started on the East Coast. Actually, in the next issue, Tomie will be having will be featuring a portfolio of yours in the next issue. So that's a good reason to buy the first issue, so you have like a series. Anyway, now to the business. Thanks so much for coming. I don't know whether it's beautiful outside, but you're here. That's the important thing. To be in the moment, to be here, and it's great to welcome Tomie Arai. I'm really an outsider. I'm from the West Coast, but throughout the years, I've known Tomie, and I've received her wonderful New Year's cards each year. There must be at least 12 animals, right? Are there 12 animals in the?
You don't know. You're Chinese.
Oh well, you know.
Yes, there are 12.
12 animals. Okay, 12 animals. And so, Tomie, you know, it's actually tonight we want to actually make it interactive. So we're going to have just a little conversation. And Tomie is going to be showing and presenting her work. And there's all of you here today. And all of you are really the experts. I see a lot of people from our generation, like Liz, and people who are actually much more knowledgeable than I am about the Asian American movement on the East Coast. Although, you know, I did participate in the West Coast. Well, Tomie, I'm going to read this very long bio because... But I'd like to actually say that Tomie is a visual artist of Asian America, and she kind of helped to put the moment on the map. And actually, part of the moment is at this exhibition in which Tomie's image served the people. This is from Pearl, right? This is from...
Actually, that was done by Arlen Wang.
Oh, this no.
Yeah.
Oh, this image. Oh no, this.
It's the.
It's the other image, right?
The postcard, which isn't on there. So.
Oh, where is it? It's on the postcard.
But I have it in my presentation.
Oh, in the presentation, it's actually on this postcard, and I'll pass the postcard around, and it's actually during the presentation. So actually, you can see more of Tomie's work at the Interference Archive in Brooklyn. And they've actually extended the exhibit through March, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I believe. Tomie is as I said, a visual artist, and put the moment when Asian Americans basically defined themselves and saw themselves as Asian Americans on the map. She's an activist, artist, philosopher, poet, historian, printmaker, installation artist, and most importantly, a public community artist. She has many, many commissions, including the Arizona Humanities Council, Cambridge Arts Council, New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, National Endowment for the Arts. She's worked for community groups for at least 30 years, done public artwork for the new Central Subway Chinatown Station in San Francisco, and a community collaboration entitled Portraits of New York Chinatown, currently on view at the Museum of Chinese in America. Tomie's work has been exhibited nationally and is in the collection of the Library of Congress, Bronx Museum of the Arts, the Japanese American National Museum, the Williams College Museum of Art, the Museum of Modern Art, and the Whitney Museum. She's been a recipient of two New York Foundation for the Arts fellowships, Joan Mitchell Visual Arts Grant, National Endowment, and many, many other grants. In the year 2000, Tomie Arai was one of 50 artists nationwide to participate in the Artists and Communities America Creates for the Millennium Project. She was a recipient of a 2003 MCAF grant, 2007 Urban Artists Initiative grant, a 2000 Arts and Activism grant from the Asian Women Giving Circle, and a 2013 Puffin Foundation grant. So Tomie, you've been really on the move.
Talking about.
And so let's give Tomie a hand before we start a conversation. And let's just start really simply. You know, I'm curious. You know, we're about the same. We're the same generation, and I'm just curious. Let's just pick a year, say 1971. And on this map put out by the Interference Archive, it says 1971, City College take over establishment of Asian American Studies. aaaricuny established. Bridge Magazine established. Amerasia Creative Arts Program, Chinatown Health Fair, Asian American Resource Center, Basement Workshop, Amerasia Journal. Yellow Pearl, published in New York City between sort of 71, 72. So in 1971, can you sort of like give us a picture of Tomie Arai in 1971 and like what you were doing, thinking,
okay,
and seeing?
I see you're not going by the script.
So. Oh yeah, no, I don't want to go by the script, yeah.
First of all, thank you so much for coming tonight. I see so many familiar faces. And it's also wonderful to know that there's so many artistic people here, musicians and photographers and writers and poets. And so I feel like I'm very good company. Let's see, in 1971, I think I met my husband. He was an office manager at Basement. He managed the office. And he was teaching a course at Hunter called the Asian American Experience, because they didn't have Asian American Studies at Hunter. And he wasn't allowed to call it Asian American History for some reason. I was a single parent. I was raising a three-year-old child on my own, and so I was trying to figure out what to do with my life. Like everybody else that I knew who didn't go to college, were trying to think sort of out of the box in terms of the choices they were going to make, and really didn't have any idea of what they were going to do or who they were. I mean, I think identity became a very big and important issue in the years to come, but 71 was sort of just the beginning of that realization that we could have a voice, we could participate in things, and we could work together.
Yeah, I think 71, I mean, that's a few years after the strikes at the San Francisco State, and I was a participant in that. And at that time in 68, 70s, there were not any Asian American, that was actually the beginning of Asian American classes, sort of a voice in terms of literature and the arts. And so forth, right? Mm-hmm. On the West Coast as well, West and East Coast. You guys had the Basement Workshop, we had the Kearney Street Workshop, and I don't remember too much, we were drinking heavily at that time.
And doing other things.
No, cheap wine at the time, so I really can't remember. That's why it's up to you to, you deal with, I know in your, you've given many talks before, and you talk a lot about the importance of kind of collective memory. And at that time in 71, what kind of community were you living in at the time? You talked a little bit about your kind of like personal life, but uh-huh. Tell us about the community that surrounded you.
Well, I guess I should begin this with a confession that I was a hippie. And I had
a hippie?
How many hippies are there in the audience? Or ex-hippies? I actually grew up, I was born in New York City, and I grew up on the Upper West Side, where there was a very small enclave of Japanese Americans. My mother was, she worked for Columbia as a librarian, so we were sort of on the peripheral, I guess the periphery of the college. For most of my life, we were living in housing on or near Columbia. But there were, our neighbors were the Kochiyamas and other Japanese Americans who had settled in that area because there were churches and there were Japanese stores and there were just the sort of beginnings of a Japanese community that actually eventually dispersed. But I remember growing up being, like many of my friends from Minnesota and the Midwest, the only Japanese American in my class. Most of the kids were black and Puerto Rican. And in fact, I lived two blocks from the junior high school I went to and the public school I went to. And I'm living in the same apartment that I grew up in, which I found out is kind of rare in this city. It's rare to find somebody who was born in New York. But even though there were the sort of beginnings of some kind of formation of a community, I never felt like I was part of one geographically. I mean, certainly not in the way that other Asian Americans on the West Coast were connected to their neighborhoods and their different, I guess, social and ethnic communities. So I think that finding community or trying to understand what that meant became a theme, a recurring theme in my work.
Can you remember the first artwork you ever did?
I can remember the first artwork that was shown.
Okay. Tell us about it.
My mother is from Hawaii, and her parents were coffee farmers. And the only reason why she came to America was because she was a maid that worked for a naval family at Pearl Harbor. And they were leaving Hawaii because they knew the Japanese were going to invade. So right before the bombing of Pearl Harbor, she left with this family, and that's how she got to the mainland. And she found her way to New England, where she worked as a maid and a kind of nanny for a family. And then she got to New York, and she always told me New York was the greatest place in the world because you could, there were so many museums and you could take advantage of all these free cultural things. And so she was, and I think because she worked in a library, you know, being able to borrow books was this wonderful, I guess, privilege that she always used to impress on me. But she managed to give me classes at the Museum of Modern Art when I was 10 years old. Because in those days, they actually had a school next to the museum. It was a two-story building, and now there's a huge condo there. But they had the second floor were all classrooms, and they were used on Saturday mornings for inner-city children. So being on the Upper West Side in a mostly black and Puerto Rican neighborhood and, you know, having parents who didn't make very much money, I was eligible. And so I used to go to the Museum of Modern Art every Saturday morning. And they would teach us how to paint abstract paintings. But the great thing was that they would let us into the museum before it opened in the morning. So that was, I always look forward to that, because you got to run around the museum when there was no one there, and it was like a cathedral. And I always used to go straight to the Van Gogh, the Starry Night. So I did a painting that was sort of inspired by that, and it was called A Place I Have Never Been Before. And they showed it at Columbia. And I got a little ribbon.
I see.
And that's why I became an artist.
Now, you had said that, as you were learning and producing art, that one of the exciting things for you is the ability to create your own art world, sort of a parallel art world, sort of parallel to sort of the mainstream or parallel to what was going on as well. And you could create this parallel. It's almost like Superman and Bizarro world, you know? I mean, a whole functioning parallel universe, mm-hmm. Which is, you know, yours. So is that, I think...
Well, I think that the best kept secret is that the art world is made up of many worlds, and that you can exist as a professional artist, you can make a living as an artist doing any number of things. They don't all have to be about making paintings that are shown in galleries and selling work. I know artists that do all kinds of things to survive. And I think that this parallel art world concept is really a form of survival for most artists, that they are, because of circumstance, sort of marginalized. I mean, I think that a lot of artists of color and artists who perhaps haven't had opportunities to go to school or for reasons of class are just not included in a lot of the programming that cultural institutions offer. So they don't have places to show. They have no way of making a living other than by sort of scrambling and trying to figure that out. And so they create their own alternatives. And I think that was what happened in the 70s, that the reason why Basement existed is because it didn't exist in the Museum of Modern Art. People had to make their own institutions, and they had to make them in their own image.
Yeah, I think it was a important, how would you say it? It was a chance that we had to create ourselves, right? Create our own kind of image, our own world, our own identity. I'm just going to ask just two more questions because we want to actually see the work instead of, you know, talk. And besides, I know all of you have a lot of questions and actually comments and perspectives that you can share with us during the evening. But during the 70s, there were sort of three phrases that we used over and over again, and we used ourselves or we heard. Let me just say them. And one is the personal is the political, that was always heard. The second is women hold up half the sky. The third is serve the people. So I was wondering if any of these three kind of rhetorical statements actually have meant something to you in your thinking. The personal is the political, women hold up half the sky, and serve the people.
I think I have artworks all named with this. In 1975, I did a mural called Women Hold Up Half the Sky, which was on East 3rd Street, on the side of a school building. I don't know how they even allowed us to do this mural, but they eventually just erased it. I think the first two statements are directly from the women's movement. And you know, the women's movement had an enormous impact on not only my generation and a whole generation of women, but feminists were actually very influential in changing the art world and really lobbying for more inclusion in this history of art and for asking this sort of official art canon to recognize different forms of art as legitimate genres of art, like craft. A lot of women's art was considered craft, and anything that women did was sort of regarded as sort of second class. So I think the women's movement really did a lot to change that. On the other hand, I feel like a lot of artists of color, and particularly women of color, were somewhat excluded from the middle class women's movement. And so the reason why I turned to China in that period of time was because there were a lot more models of strong women and the ways in which women could contribute to changing society that I didn't see happening here. I mean, I didn't see that has changed, of course, in the last few decades, but there weren't a whole lot of role models for Asians in this country. Aside from the models that we saw in like very strong militant grassroots groups like the Panthers or the Young Lords Party. But you know, a lot of the models that we used or were inspired that inspired our work came from outside of the country, from China or South America or Cuba or the Third World.
Yeah, I remember the New Socialist China. Remember that one poster which had the profiles of faces of various colors, mm-hmm. sort of brown, yellow, red, white, black, and also, you know, the Cuban posters, which were, you know, really innovative in terms of aesthetically their composition and their coloring. And so, I mean, I think that was a time in which the Third World was international, but as Asian Americans, as, you know, being situated in America, we basically borrowed or we looked toward the outside, right? Because there were very few examples inside.
Well, I think we were inspired by and borrowed a great deal from the kinds of political formations that existed in third world countries. And it was all about self-reliance. It was about working together collectively, really examining where power lay. And how to challenge that. It's all about establishing equity in the way decisions were made. And a lot of those strategies for organizing people, you know, people are still doing today, thanks to, I think, the experiences that we, or the lessons drawn from what we've seen happen in other countries.
Now you...
I was just going to... first of all, thank you all for those of you who have told me they like the card that I do. I'm, you know, always very, very sort of moved when I hear that, because I always think of it as free art, as a gift. You know, I'm on my 25th year of doing these cards, so the first 12 cards... all the animals were pointed, were actually facing one way. And so this year, this cycle, I've had to like reverse the way they're facing because I didn't want them to be, people have told me sometimes that they put them up on the wall and I thought, oh, well, you know, they're both facing the same way. It's gonna look kind of funny. But it's so ingrained in me that everything should face the left because this is what we were taught when we were working in the movement. You know, it's completely out of these sort of crazy cultural revolution guidelines, you know, that any poster that you see from that period, people will be facing left. So there were all these little things that completely changed our worldview that we, you know, it's kind of embarrassing to say this, but you know, we would spend hours like debating and discussing.
Oh, with the study groups and so forth?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I think the East Coast people were a lot more serious. On the West Coast, we spent hours drinking and reading poetry, and you guys were in study cells, right?
Well, some of us were.
I see. But, you know, I mean, the hippie movement started on the West Coast, so, you know, it's too seductive, you know.
Well, I'm old enough to say that that was before I came to, you know, got involved in the Asian American movement, yeah.
Now, I know we want to see Tomie's actual work, so last question is, by defining yourself as a public artist, what does that mean, that you're, you work with other people, or that you're, you see it, your work as for a broader audience, or the strategy is different in terms of being a public artist and being a, I don't know what the opposite of being a public artist, would it be a private artist? But maybe you can just talk a little bit about your being a public artist, and then we actually can go into your work and into an interactive discussion.
Well, I have to admit, Russell, I appreciated your introduction, but I was cringing a little when you were telling everyone I was a philosopher and an activist. And
no, I read it on the web.
Well, yeah, I believe everything you read on the web.
Oh, I do. Okay.
I think that sometimes I actually embrace labels. I have no problem being considered an Asian American artist or a woman artist or a feminist or any of those things. A public artist in my mind is sort of a phrase that I use to distinguish myself from an artist that only works in the studio. It has a lot to do with what we call art production or art practice these days. But it's a kind of intentional way of saying that I see my work in. I prefer to see the work in the context of a public space, when I was making work at Basement, or when I was when I was much younger and I was working on the streets and painting murals, I really felt like I only wanted to work outside of galleries and outside of the museum system or the art world. But I'm beginning to see now that there are different ways that you can make work and different spaces and different audiences that you can make work for. So I guess that, and I must be all over the place here, but I think that when I say public, it's really about a kind of accessibility that I'm sort of working towards. And I think a lot of people work in very different ways. A lot of artists don't want to be able to have their work accessible immediately. I mean, they want people to think about it a little or to even draw back from it. By accessibility, I don't mean that it's easily read necessarily, but that I feel like there should be something in the work that touches people in a way that they're not removed from it. So.
Now, you know, I guess one of the goals of being a public artist is to touch people and to be able to basically have this kind of mutual access. My last question is, what was the most difficult public art project that you've worked on in terms of working with people or with a sort of a community or the sort of aesthetics of it or just the technical part in terms of it's very daunting? Or can you just sort of give us one example of so that we know that it's not easy to be an artist and that basically as a public artist, there's so many considerations sometimes, you know, you run into issues which you have to solve, you know.
Maybe you can. Well, I agree that it's hard, it's very challenging. A lot of artists don't like working in the community because there's an element of it's so unpredictable. It's a process that you can't go into with assuming a lot. You have to be very receptive, and every project is different, so there's always a different set of challenges. Like if you, for instance, I'm supposed to be doing a work of art for the subway that they're building in San Francisco Chinatown. It's called the Central Subway Project. It's a huge project, and it's right in the middle of Stockton and Washington Street, and it's going to be hugely disruptive. So there are all kinds of built-in challenges to this project that have to do with being a representative of this MTA, this agency that, you know, that the community doesn't like, and trying to find a way to involve them in a process that if they weren't involved in, it would just be done without them. So, you know, you have to try to convince them that, and this is what happens with gentrification and all of these other developments in the community. If the community is not involved, they're engaged, it's just going to happen. And the whole place is going to be remade without them. So the challenge is to try to convince people that they should have some ownership over these spaces. That's a very different challenge from putting a mural up in on the Lower East Side and, you know, finding that there are two different kinds of groups in the same block and, you know, trying to negotiate what they would like to see and have them come together. And I guess in both cases, you're kind of a catalyst or a mediator, or you're not just the artist, you're having to assume a lot of roles. But I would say that for people who work in the community, at least 50% of the time they're failing. They're not succeeding, or they're not reaching what they thought they were going, some goal. I mean, that's built in, and that's what is the beauty of doing this kind of work. It's, you can't guarantee anything, and you, it's always something you learn from.
Oh, I'm actually really surprised and happy that you are doing it in the subway, because Stockton, Washington is where I was born and raised. It's the most congested, one of the most congested corners in Chinatown. And, you know, now I saw, I guess there must be a hole, they must be excavating. There's a wall, sort of like that where there used to be a building. And I guess, are you going to be doing a mural or a part of a...
They want a two-sided glass architectural wall on the roof of the building.
Oh, that you'll be doing?
Yeah.
Oh, good. We tell people, don't keep your fingers clean and don't muck up the wall, right? Muck up the glass. It's way up. That's actually a place of honor, right? I mean, up in the heavens, right? The sky will be...
Okay.
Oh, that's great. So congratulations on building the Great Wall. The Great Glass Wall.
Oh, that's a great name for
right?
that.
The Great Wall. And at this point, I'm going to let Tomie continue and actually do a presentation.
I presented part of this, these images to, last summer, and I've tried to make it a little more specific to this group. So, in 1991, the year that marked the 50th anniversary of the bombing of Pearl Harbor, the rise of Japan's economy and the loss of U.S. jobs led to a wave of anti-Japanese violence that swept across the country. In response to Japan bashing in the media, I created a series of portraits of Japanese Americans in New York as a way to represent the community as a more complex and multi-layered entity. 18 portraits of family members, friends, and colleagues were arranged along the walls of a 15 by 15 foot room and the Alternative Museum. In this installation, a bicultural and multi-generational mix of Japanese Americans were juxtaposed with mass media images and racial stereotypes that were transferred onto shattered glass panels. Placed strategically at eye level, this formation of portraits was presented as a way to formally introduce these members to the community and to the public, and to challenge our assumptions about what it meant to be both Japanese and American within the larger national discourse of race and identity. The captions below the portraits, Japanese Jewish American, Japanese Chinese American, and in this slide, second generation Japanese African American, were presented as counterpoints to the labels deceitful, monstrous, sneaky, and sly printed under the glass stereotypes. Shards of glass printed with images of historic events such as the Vietnam War underscored the impact of these events on the lives of Asians in America. About this installation, author Kerry Sakamoto wrote, "No longer the partly veiled presence, the recessed image, the Asian American has now become the agent of her or his own construction. On the ledge on which the planks rest, shattered bits of glass have been retrieved to suggest a ceremony of placement. These are fragments from shattered images referring to events, the civil rights movement, the Vietnam War, the World War II internment of Japanese Americans, the devastation of Hiroshima, that have shaped the history of people of color in the United States." In framing an American identity, Arai herself faces, she's continuing to write about me, arrives face to face with the other, for the work is about what finally clears the frame, the infinite experience of Americans of color that cannot be reductively defined or contained. So in revisiting this installation 20 years later, I realize how deeply absorbed I was in the creation of an authentic space for myself within a community that felt, for as long as I could remember, elusive and imaginary. The Japanese Americans I knew growing up in New York were sansei, yansei, hapa, and married to non-Japanese. They couldn't speak the language, hadn't been to Japan, and like my own children, were of mixed race. Framing an American Identity was the first project I had created to attempt to address the unique experiences of Japanese Americans living on the East Coast. And it was as much about framing my own identity as it was about constructing an alternative community that embraced the impossibility of defining or containing difference. This installation and these installation views are of the recent exhibit, If They Came For Me Today, East Coast Stories from the Japanese American Internment Project, organized by Community Works in 2013. And I see Suki Ports in the back, who was also part of that project. Created in commemoration of the 25th anniversary of the Civil Liberties Act of 1988, the Japanese American Project, as it was called, invited young students from Harlem to meet and interview Japanese Americans living in New York. Though this collaboration resulted in a celebration of shared experiences, it was still clear that misconceptions about the Japanese in America persist, and the need to apply the historical lessons drawn from the internment to current social justice issues like stop and frisk and racial profiling remain more urgent than ever. Today, we take the cultural complexity that defines our communities for granted. But as a young artist living in New York 20 years before the creation of Framing an American Identity and 40 years before If They Came For Me Today, my friends and I were busy rejecting our differences, embracing the label of Asian American, and actively subverting the notion that Orientals were a monolithic yellow race by celebrating our sameness. To understand this trajectory, I would have to go back to 1972 and my involvement in Yellow Pearl, an unbound collection of poetry, music, and art about Asian American identity, centered around the music of folk musicians Nobuko Miyamoto, Chris Ijima, and Charlie Chin, that has been recognized as influencing a generation of Asian American artists and writers. As a young artist still finding my voice, my experience working on Yellow Pearl had a profound impact on my views about art and art making. Meeting in a basement in Chinatown for over a year, those of us who had never met, worked alongside, or collaborated with other Asian Americans created a visual manifesto representing diverse responses to the social events of the day. Poems about the war in Vietnam, Chinatown, the women's movement, and third world solidarity were included along with love songs, angry rants, cartoon stereotypes, and a recipe for barbecued spare ribs. The printing of Yellow Pearl fueled the growth of Basement Workshop, a community arts organization located in the heart of Chinatown. Under Fei Chang's direction and her vision for an organization engaged in the production of an Asian American culture, AmerAsia Arts, Bridge Magazine, the Asian American Resource Center, which became the Museum of Chinese Americas, and the Community Planning Workshop brought students, activists, and community residents together as volunteers to bring much-needed services to the Chinatown community. This is a poster that I designed for Basement. Bridge Magazine, a bi-monthly publication founded by Danny Young and edited by Frank Ching, was a repository of essays, political articles, poetry, and art about issues affecting Asians in America. Contributing illustrations for Bridge, designing graphics and posters, and meeting weekly to discuss cultural projects, I was provided with endless opportunities to explore the production of images of Asians in America and form bonds with other Asian American artists that would last over decades. Margot Machida, a Japanese American painter with experience working at both Basement Workshop and the Asian American Arts Center, went on to become a respected curator and one of the founding members of Godzilla in 1991. More culturally diverse than Basement Workshop and more overtly career-based, Godzilla functioned as a collective, a social club, and a loose network of artists and arts professionals advocating for cultural equity. Under the leadership of Ken Chu, Godzilla established itself as a dynamic forum for mutual support, and an open space for artists, critics, and curators to be heard as well as recognized. In contrast to Godzilla's stated mission and goals, Margot Machida wrote about her experiences as an artist in the 1970s, and I quote her here. She says, like many local Asian artists, I did not participate in Chinatown community life until I had a specific connection through basement workshop. In my first few visits, I learned the basement was run by second and third generation Asians, like myself, and that it offered a social group which I understood and felt comfortable with. In particular, I was attracted to those aspects of basement workshop that were grounded in the 70s counterculture. That is, an emphasis on feminism, cultural self-affirmation, and a participatory decision-making process. A combination of several factors made basement unique, even among Asian groups. One, it was run by a second-generation Asian-American woman. Two, that would be Fei Chang. Two, it had an interactive, peer-oriented structure rather than the traditional hierarchical authority system of Asian families. And three, it had a long history of multi-ethnic interactions with artists outside Chinatown. These characteristics, which embodied the Americanized attitudes of its founders, made basement a magnet for many second and third generation artists like myself, and pointed toward a new type of Asian organization which could move toward the art mainstream while retaining its unique sense of an ethnic consciousness. In addition to posters, art production in the 70s also included leaflets advertising demonstrations against the war, anti-war teach-ins, and fundraisers for Asian American organizations like the Asian Coalition Against the War, all of which were printed on the obligatory canary yellow stationery. Liz, do you recognize yourself? The influence of China's Cultural Revolution was evident in all our work. Before the U.S. official recognition of the People's Republic of China in 1979, Mao's Little Red Book and his writings on art and culture were a form of contraband in Chinatown and a source of constant debate and discussion. In this tableau, based on the social realist images of Chinese posters, the guerrilla theater group, Asian Tactical Theater, is seen rehearsing a performance for an anti-war demonstration. Performing on the street and on college campuses in and around New York, AT&T was one of many cultural forms created to protest the war in Vietnam and promote basement as both a rehearsal space and a locus for many leftist groups engaged in anti-war activities. The history of Chinese immigration to the U.S. was a mural painted in 1972 under the direction of Alan Okada as a partnership between Basement Workshop and City Arts Workshop, a community arts organization that painted murals on the Lower East Side with teenagers, local artists, and activists. These community muralists were determined to take art out of the studio and demystify the art-making process by bringing art onto the streets of the community. Everything from planning, design, style, content, and fabrication was decided collectively. The murals were large visual statements about the neighborhood, and without the benefit of the internet, we relied in large part on our own recollections of events to create and retell stories about our lives. This is a mural that was called Wall of Respect for the Working People of Chinatown, and I think there's a hotel there now. It's on Hester and Bowery. The peer-oriented structure Margot Machida used to describe basement was what drew me to Chinatown, to painting murals, and ultimately to the development of community-based projects that involved processes that continue to be at the heart of my work today. The murals gave us a space to take the rigorous discussions about the function of art and the role of the artist out into the world and to put theory into practice and then reconvene for even more discussions that critiqued our successes and failures. It was through this laboratory of experience and trial and error that I began to respect and understand the challenges of working with the community. I've often spoken about the murals as the classroom in which I learned to become an artist, and it is a theme I return to again and again. Since those gritty days on the Lower East Side, the exchange of stories that captivated me as a muralist still inform my art practice, but it is a framework for collaboration that was hammered out through years of painting on the streets that continues to drive my social practice. Our mantra, each participant has a voice, still resonates for me as I begin each new project. Unity as a framework for collaboration was a common theme expressed in the murals, especially in communities with histories of poverty and violence. Local artists who had roots in the neighborhoods they lived and worked in were seen as essential to the success of a project, and artists marginalized by the art world were encouraged to participate and find employment as mural directors and assistants. These closely formed relationships between artists, community residents, and local youth opened up the possibility for us to explore the ways that an artist can move beyond the role of outsider and ethnographer and use this position to become an active participant in community dialogues about the nature and significance of place. Other collaborations with communities of artists grew organically from my relationship to Basement, which was a member of the Seven Loaves Coalition of Arts Groups on the Lower East Side. The Seven Loaves Coalition, with its storefront on East 6th Street and between A and 1st, included City Arts Workshop, Charas, Plaza Cultural, and the Lower East Side Print Shop, a keyholder printmaking workshop that I became a member of for over 20 years. With the exception of Basement, all six organizations were within blocks of each other. Like Basement, small artist-run organizations like the Lower East Side Print Shop and the Robert Blackburn Printmaking Workshop were important workshops founded in the early 70s that primarily served artists of color. Workspace programs and print shops were fertile laboratories for collaboration and for artists experimenting with the printed image. Robert Blackburn, seen here in this print by Jason Sons, was instrumental in mentoring and training hundreds of artists of color from all parts of the globe during his lifetime. My experience in these spaces can't be underscored enough. They were really essential to my development as an artist. As a printmaker, I used the years following my training in these shops to explore ways I could use printmaking as a tool to bring art to the community and as a medium for both production and social interaction. Double Happiness is a silkscreen print that asks the viewer to consider the hybrid and bicultural history of East LA. It was printed at Self-Help Graphics, a community arts organization established to empower and support the work of emerging Latino artists in Los Angeles. In this print, Chinese flashcards, Japanese cards from a matching game, Hanafuda, and Mexican Loteria cards are displayed as the touchstones for choices made by people in their journey to America. The maps and picture cards were used as devices to connect the disparate communities that have a shared history in Boyle Heights. A print residency at Bowdoin College provided first-year printmaking students with the opportunity to help an artist print an edition of etchings. The finished print, the edition entitled Karma, was divided among the students, the artist, and faculty at its completion. Swirl was a visual portal between Chinatown proper and Chinatown North, located in the Vine Street Plaza in the middle of the Vine Street Expressway in Philadelphia. As part of a program that was called Chinatown in Flux, Swirl marked the changing boundaries of Philadelphia's Chinatown. The installation takes the shape of a large sphere based on the jade bee or disc traditionally worn by the Chinese as a pendant or talisman. Silkscreened images of local residents and historical photographs cover the surface of this sculpture to create an overlapping cityscape, a swirl of change and flux that reflects the urban environment and the unique history of Philadelphia's Chinatown. In developing the concept for this piece, which was also silkscreen, I work collaboratively with the members of the Chinatown community, the staff of the Asian Arts Initiative, the families of the Chinatown Learning Center, and the Philadelphia Chinatown Development Corporation. So these were some of the staff people that helped me with the project. And finally, a renewal, a 35-foot-long silkscreen monoprint, was created in 1998 to memorialize the discovery of the African burial ground in Lower Manhattan. Using the silkscreen process to create a layered reading of the history of slavery in colonial New York, I attempted to replicate the archaeological process of sifting through layers of information to present a historical perspective. Images in the mural span a time period from the 1600s to 1827, a period that covers the recorded history and existence of the African burial ground. The mural hangs in the lobby of the Ted Weiss Federal Building at 290 Broadway. One more, let's see. The shape of me, that's me silkscreening. The shape of me is a silkscreen banner made up of dozens of images of Afghan men, women, and children superimposed over images of people from the Vietnam War. Created for a traveling exhibition sponsored by the American Friends Service Committee, entitled, the exhibit was called Art in the Mirror. This banner refers to the thousands of innocent lives lost in wars waged by the United States in Asia and the Middle East. Printed in camouflage colors, it brings attention to the collateral damage that often goes undocumented and unrecognized. This piece is about the ways in which the catastrophic damage inflicted on innocent people as a result of war has across the decades been internalized into our national identity and our sense of who we are in the world. So printmaking also brought me to the doors of the Chinatown History Museum in 1998. This is actually a design that I did for the opening panel of the permanent exhibit at the new MoCA on 215 Center Street. And I just wanted to talk about the importance of having a sustained relationship with an organization that is rooted in the community and how that has helped to deepen my art practice and allowed me to build relationships to the community. My relationship to the Chinatown History Museum actually covers a span of about 24 years because I was their first artist in residence in 1988. And one of the first things I did was a silkscreen project called the Mother-Daughter Project, which was a series of silkscreen prints based on interviews with Asian women living in New York. And at that time, very few people were doing oral histories. It's sort of a common practice now. But it was a very important research practice for the museum. And it was something initiated by Jack Chen, who was then the director and is now the director of the Asian Pacific American Studies Institute. It was my introduction, really, to this process, which I've begun to use really extensively for all of the public projects that I've done. In this print series, women of Chinese, Japanese, Burmese, Indian, and Korean descent were the subjects of these prints, which were printed in a very small, limited edition and presented as gifts to the families who were interviewed. I was inspired by Toni Morrison's essay, The Site of Memory, and her reflections on how she gained access to the interior life of her subjects. And in this essay, Morrison describes her writing as a process of discovery and, quote, a kind of archaeology. And she says, on the basis of some information and a little bit of guesswork, you journey to a site to see what remains were left behind. And this journey helps you reconstruct a story about your life. Her reliance on photographic snapshots, on the photographic remains of my family, in addition to recollection, yields up a kind of truth and self-awareness. So in these portraits of mothers and daughters, it was important for me to place the subject of my work in relation to family, work, and community, and to think about how each of the people interviewed or researched through the archives became an entrance to my own interior life. And in Morrison's words, and my route to the reconstruction of a world that surfaced as a revelation of a kind of truth. So another print project were these 45-foot-long silkscreen banners. that were created for the stairwell of the Museum of Chinese in Americas. They were housed in a school building on Mulberry Street with a grant from Creative Time. And these banners were created in conjunction with an exhibition that, Ed, are you here? What was the name of the exhibition? Remembering New York Chinatown?
Okay, I'll go with that.
Okay. the first permanent exhibition for the museum. It was designed to fill a five-story stairwell and to be read as one went up the stairs. Created in collaboration with historians and community activists and designed to be read while traveling up or down the five-story stairwell of the building, these banners incorporated historical photographs from the archives as well as personal family photographs donated to the project by the community. The banners were meant to unfurl as pages of public history and a record of the past, community portraits framed within tenement windows of historic buildings in Chinatown served as the juncture through which both outsiders and community residents were able to perceive each other. At the heart of this narrative lies a human life, which now resides in the permanent collection of the Bronx Museum, and you could also see it if you went to MoCA today, was based entirely on archival material from the museum. A young woman embedded in a map of Chinatown is surrounded by historical images of Chinatown in the form of tour guide books, sheet music covers, magazine illustrations filled with erroneous information about Chinese culture, which were culled from the museum's collection and were used to frame perceptions of the community. So I guess it's the culmination of my work, although I think the recent project would probably be the culmination, but as an example of a very successful collaborative effort, I worked with the museum around a project called Double Happiness, and it was a project that documented the migration experiences of Chinese Latinos and Chinese Caribbeans in both New York and Miami. And in this project, students, historians, artists, and community activists working in collaboration with Miami-Dade Community College, the Bronx Museum of the Arts, and the Museum of Chinese in the Americas participated in gathering over 40 oral histories conducted with Chinese whose origins of, countries of origin included Cuba, Peru, Guatemala, Mexico, Panama, Jamaica, Trinidad, and Haiti. The project began in Miami as part of a residence at Miami-Dade Community College, and seen here are historian Josephine Gordy in the middle, Susan DePena on the right, and historian Evelyn Hudahart, who's a leading authority on and scholar on the subject of the Chinese diaspora in Latin America. As the largest community college in the United States with a student body of over 80% recent immigrants, Miami-Dade initiated a Chinese in the Americas project that brought me to their campus to work with students to conduct interviews with the Chinese community in South Florida. In fact, actually, I was so surprised when I got there because there were no Chinese in this class that I was going to work with. And most of the students said they had never even spoken to anyone who was Chinese. So this was a learning experience for all of us. Interviews took place in schools, homes, and places of business with both Spanish and Chinese-speaking translators over a several-month period. The owner of this Cuban-Chinese restaurant in Little Havana, who spoke only Chinese and Spanish, invited us to his apartment next to the restaurant and surprised us with a calligraphy demonstration. In 1998, the project culminated in an installation for the Bronx Museum called Double Happiness, the Chinese character for marriage, which was used to symbolize and celebrate the marriage of cultures and the bicultural experiences of the Chinese diaspora. In this installation, silkscreen portraits are arranged around a banquet table, and excerpts from oral histories are printed onto the backs of the guests' chairs, like fragments of conversations overheard in a banquet hall. Family portraits, like this portrait of a Haitian-Chinese family, were arranged to form the centerpiece of each of the three tables that was lit from underneath. The viewer, as a guest, is asked to consider the Americas as a place where hybridity is the norm, a space where identity has less to do with being than with a state of perpetual becoming. Today, we recognize that every North American, Latin American, and Caribbean country is home to people of Chinese ancestry. Double Happiness was a project of unusual richness and diversity because very few of us had fixed ideas about race in this exploratory exchange. And it says here, it's an excerpt, "What I know of being Chinese comes from my life in the Caribbean, and what I know of the Caribbean is shaped by my experience of being Chinese there." And these two images are taken from the exhibit that's currently at the museum, which is entitled Beyond the Streets. If you haven't gone, I'd really encourage you to go. It's actually the first time the museum is presenting three exhibits about Chinatown, which includes Portraits of New York Chinatown, the project that I did with the museum, based entirely on oral histories. And I see Henry Chang is here. He was one of my subjects. Photographs by Annie Ling of Chinatown, and a wonderful installation about the Lee family in the back of the museum. So I'd just like to end with just a few comments about the importance, again, of these collaborations with community organizations and institutions. And this is actually a catalog by the artist Roger Shimomura. And I just preface this by saying that I was invited to be the first artist in residence at the Asian Pacific American Studies program at NYU in 1998. And I sort of managed to swing full circle to become a visiting scholar there this year. And I was invited to contribute to this catalog of Roger Shimomura's work when he was artist in residence last year. And both Roger and I are printmakers. And in my little catalog essay, I took the opportunity to remark that we were both sanseis, and we were both always trying to tell the same stories. So being paired with him was really an honor. But I realized, you know, that it was an example of how institutions can bring people together in the same way that Basement, as a very small organization, was able to do so magnificently, you know, in the 70s, and how important that is in terms of an artist's life to belong to a community. And other examples of the Asian American Studies program, residency program, is their encouragement of the artists that are fortunate enough to work with them to create new work, like these paintings that I did about post-internment experience of Japanese in America, which I based on a Japanese folktale called Momotaro, and two paintings from that series. An exhibition that I installed in the APA Studies office. It was a gallery space designed by Maya Lin with a student at the time, Siddhartha Jogue, called Resident Aliens. And it was shortly after Sid graduated that he was also part of that installation, which was an online racial profiling survey that people could fill out in the gallery. But Sid went on to found an organization called Zero Capital, which was following very much in the footsteps of Basement and Godzilla, but with a much more radical edge. And it's a collaboration between Sid and Fei Chang. This amazing new publication from the Asian American Literary Journal, is that right? Literary Journal? It just came out, and includes and features a number of essays about Asian American art in the 90s. And there is an interesting section curated by Alexandra Chang from APA Institute about visual artists and the ways in which they were working in that decade. And finally, I end with the beginning. The Interference Archives show that was curated by Ryan Wong that's currently been extended until March, and I urge you all to go see it if you're interested in the 70s and the Asian American movement at that time. Thank you.
Okay, let's give Tomie a 1 second break before the deluge of comments and questions from all of you out there. I wanted to also plug our CUNY forum. Actually, Tomie will be having a portfolio of her work in the next one. And also Ryan Wong, the curator of the Interference Archive, wrote a special essay from his generational point of view of why Ryan is in his 20s. And he actually was he curated this first show on the Asian American movement on the East Coast. And so we asked him to write an essay from his generation's point of view why he did it. So let's, I'm sure all of you have comments and questions.
Okay.
Just raise your hand and we can start. Yes. Can you identify yourself as well? Because we'd like to know you.
Sure. I'm Ed Lai. I'm a good friend of Tomie, so I'm going to ask a very gentle question.
A softball question.
As an artist, you produce work. What do you think about people who collect your work in terms of buyers? And who are they?
You're going to embarrass me here. People don't buy my work. I mean, I don't have a gallery. Not that I wouldn't want to sell it. I mean, I don't think it would be very disingenuous of any artist to say that they wouldn't want somebody to purchase their work or support what they're doing. I think that art is supposed to be shared in whatever way or form that happens. But the choice not to be shown in a commercial gallery is actually an intentional one. Who knows if that opportunity hadn't come to me, I wouldn't have taken it. But perhaps because of all the other choices I've made about the kind of work that I do or... perhaps the content of the work, I'm not sure. Could be a combination of anything. That hasn't been an issue for me. What was your question about
the... the reason I ask is that I do see you enjoy the process. You get, before the product is out there, before the execution of your art, the collective process that you go through in every piece of work that you do, it's quite successful. The process, as a designer, I appreciate the process too. So I could see that in your work, and the joy that you get out of the process, working with the communities and various kind of. Situations, that's why I asked the question about how, and you comment earlier that you know you define yourself as a public art. You want to share your creativity, share your art work with people, and I see that you do that, but most artists define themselves in terms of success. Is how many people purchase their work, and I don't see that, I don't see that in you so much.
Actually, that's a really interesting question because I feel like there are two the work that, how do you know that I only showed you the successful projects first of all, but I think that making work in a community setting or in a public setting is not the same as making work in your studio. And I'm not placing any value judgment on what is better or in my own life, I think there's always some kind of an internal struggle about how to bring what I do in the studio out of the studio and whether or not it even belongs outside of the studio. Because, you know, why wouldn't, as an artist, why wouldn't you want to explore all kinds of work? And some work just isn't ready to be shown, or the people may not understand, and you may not feel like you want to bring that kind of work out into a public space. So I do make a very strong distinction between studio practice and work in a public venue. But that said, I think that you're touching on like how artists make a living, how, you know, what I call sustainability. And people do what they do, or what they can do to survive, and most people are only trying to make enough money so that they can make work. But for some people that's enough, for some it's not. So I just had this very interesting conversation, and I was just talking to Tayo about it. I had met a young woman, young artist, very ambitious, who spent a lot of time talking about branding and how important that was for her as an artist to get out into the world. And I was thinking at the time that it was such a different way of thinking about your work. And it had a lot to do with this idea of authorship. So like coming from the 60s and the 70s, which was a sort of counterculture, hippie, sort of pseudo-leftist time, I think we were not concerned with these issues of authorship. In fact, we went bent over backwards to not sign anything. And I remember this huge discussion in Yellow Pearl about whether or not they should even include the names of the people who worked on Yellow Pearl in the volume. And Alex Chin, who is a great cartoonist, proposed that he would just draw pictures of people. You know, we put that on in the anthology, and the people would have to guess who these people were. But years later, you know, people are now asking me to identify the artwork, and because they want to display it, and it adds value to the piece. If you can have it signed, or it's, you know, identified as being made by a certain person. So I feel like this issue, even like my talking to you tonight, is something that I would never have done years ago, because I think that has to do with this sort of coming out from behind the camera or behind the canvas, or you know, having this authorship of something. So it's sort of natural that people who have that attitude wouldn't really go to great extents to promote themselves or sell their work. Or it's always a struggle, and I think that's kind of where I'm at now. To be quite honest, I really don't have a very good answer to that.
Well, I don't hear it as an either or, Tomie, because when we were doing the work back in the 70s, we were creating something out of nothing. Mm-hmm. So the impulse that we had, whether it was art or theater or drama or whatever, dance, whatever we were doing, was to say this is who we are. And the fact that 50, 40 years later, that a young woman could come to you and talk about branding, in a way, it's that they're standing on our shoulders, mm-hmm. your shoulders. Mm-hmm. And so it's not... I can see it as a progression of development of the success of what was done in the 70s, and how now it gives them different kinds of opportunities that we may not have had, we weren't really concerned about in the early 70s, because we were just trying to figure out, this is who am I? Who are we?
Well, I like that a lot. I mean,
you can say
that. I'll tell Sarah.
No, you don't have to be apologetic or anything. I mean, I think it's just that those of us who were involved in the early 70s in creating the movement, that was our job, was to put the, to put art, to put visuals to the experience, like Nobuko and Chris and Charlie put music and words to the experience, you were doing it with art. And so it's a whole different impetus of why we did what we did back then. And I see that the two generations removed, that somebody could be talking about success as an artist is actually a tribute to what we had done then.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's a very supportive and positive way to think about that. I think we live in this world where one of your questions, Russell gave me this list of questions, none of which he asked me. One of them was, what is the difference between now and then, or something like that. And you know, I couldn't, it's such a big question, I couldn't even answer it. You know, we didn't have email or iPhones or reality TV or anything.
I think we're talking about, you know, for a lot of younger people, like I see some of my students from Hunter. You know, a lot of you might know about the, you know, Occupy Wall Street movement, and I think I had asked you whether, you know, how, what kind of difference you see in the kind of social movements now and then, you know, I mean, or do you see them as similar?
I would have to say just quickly that I think everything has changed. I mean, there's nothing the same. And I'll get to you in a sec, Sue.
It'll be over, right?
But, you know, I think one of the biggest things that has changed is the demographics, the critical mass of Asians in this country. And, you know, the following on that fact is the visibility of Asians. And I think that, you know, the need for making these images that we were trying to construct in the 70s is a different process. But I also feel like there's certainly the danger of, I guess there's a good and bad side to this idea of success and visibility in both the media and the art world. And the good thing is that we are now, some of us are the gatekeepers. We're the people who can give opportunities to people. But I think the negative side is that everything gets absorbed and co-opted, and anything that's radical just gets twisted into a commodity. So, it's talking about political art it's hard to do.
No, you know, a couple of days ago, I mean, I always have Asian American artists complain to me that, well, nowadays the hot art market is the artists from China, mainland China, and that basically we Asian American artists, you know, we don't get the same kind of media attention as those people. And I was wondering what...
But that's always been the case, and I think the reason why Godzilla formed was because they wanted a forum for Asian American artists, and institutions like Japan Society and Asia Society were not recognizing the work of Asians living here. And it's true in California with the Mexican Museum, and you know, it exists in a lot of places where they're so-called culturally specific institutions, but they don't really work with local artists at all. But I feel like another big difference is that we've gone from the local to the global, and you know, we used to talk about community as neighborhood, and we used to talk about it as the place we lived in physically, and the block, and the city, and now we're talking about the world. So I think it just makes sense that now we're talking about China in a different way.
So earlier you mentioned the project that you're doing in the San Francisco Chinatown and kind of your role as an artist and kind of getting the community to kind of take ownership or participate in the space, because gentrification is going to happen with or without them. And I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit more about that and what you see it as the role of artists today in dealing with all of these changes that communities are facing.
Hmm. You know, I think that, I mean, I'm grateful to the museum for having the thoughtfulness to think about their impact on the community when they left Mulberry Street and moved to Center Street, because they realized that by moving to, I mean, people were saying, why are you leaving Chinatown? They were only going to Center Street, but in the, you know, just only 4 or 5 years ago, the boundaries of Chinatown were shifting a lot. And I think they realized that by building a museum in this industrial area, it was going to impact the rent and the way that people traveled through that neighborhood, and it would have all kinds of implications. So I think that they were also aware of the fact that artists have been used to gentrify areas, and that they play a role in being this sort of advance guard of gentrification. And, you know, I talk to a lot of artists, and they say, you know, they think that because they're poor, or they're as poor as everybody in the neighborhood, that somehow they're not responsible. But I don't think that it helps to villainize groups in this sort of, because there's this momentum happening. So I don't have the answers, and I know that people have been struggling with zoning issues and all kinds of things in Chinatown for several years. It's very heated and very controversial. But I do feel like, I feel like people have to come to the table and they have to take part in it in some way, because not all gentrification is bad. But if it's going to happen, it has to be designed with the community in mind somehow. And as urban planners or as designers or people who have some kind of creative way of creating solutions, maybe artists can play a role in it. But they do have to be very self-aware of how they participate in the way that neighborhoods change, and how they inadvertently like create these real estate changes by being there. I don't know, is that helpful?
Yeah. This is kind of on a different topic, but first of all, thank you for showing your work. It's really beautiful. You talked a lot about community spaces and feeling like your practice was very much influenced by belonging to a community. And it seems like in your work you show a lot of imagery of different kinds of Asian tropes and imagery that comes from that kind of community and communal imagery. But I wonder if, or what you think basically about contemporary, maybe younger generations, going back to that question earlier, being Asian American artists and maybe not using that same kind of imagery, or if you think it's possible to be kind of successful in terms of your work, not in terms of monetary value, but like accomplishing some kind of goal in terms of the Asian American experience. If you're an Asian American artist, not using those same kinds of images.
You know, I think that it's very hard to define what Asian American art is or what it looks like. And in fact, I don't even know if it really exists. I think that when we were in basement, we talked about building an Asian American culture, but we didn't really understand what that meant, or we couldn't see far enough down the road to a point where 80% of all Japanese in America are marrying out of race, and you know, what does that mean in terms of how we look, or how we hold on to traditions or don't. So I feel that what comes with this sort of critical mass of Asians in this country is this liberty, or I guess freedom, to not have to tell the same story over and over again. And I really just embrace the idea that people are not making the same work and doing it in the same way. So what Liz said, you know, they're sort of standing on the shoulders of other people before them. But it wouldn't have been possible unless those stories had been told first. I guess the problem is always that we forget, or those stories get erased, so sometimes we do have to reinforce them. But I, you know, I feel like there's this phenomenon happening now where people are involved in what's called socially engaged art, and it's a new term in the art world. You know, we used to call it community art. Now it's got a very formal art term. And so along with this, you know, comes this kind of institutionalization of the way that people work with other people and communities. And so what was once so radical, which was to bring art out of the studio and to talk to people and to engage non-artists in art, is now becoming the way that artists work. So we think that people need to sort of rethink what it means to make something that's genuinely authentic, or, you know, that really comes from a genuine interaction. You know, and it isn't just some formula that you apply to, this is how you work in the community, this is how you make a mural, this is, you know, how you work with Black and Latino groups or whatever. Because all that is out there and it's on the internet, you know, you could just Google it. Yeah, but I really think that that's the job of younger artists, is to create new ways to do things and new images.
Hi. In relation to that, the project that you're working on in San Francisco, clearly it's in the Chinese community. And getting back to what is Asian American art, what do you draw from for that particular project, being that it's so closely tied to the community? What do you draw from that? Is Asian American, is Chinese American? Or do you, for that project?
You know, just going back to this Asian American art thing, I think one of the things that changed for me was 9/11, because I feel like it just blew my mind. I mean, it changed the whole way that I looked at the Asian experience in America. And, you know, we're so focused on America, so focused on this history and this history of immigration, and just kind of completely forgot about the rest of the world. And so that's what factors into my difficulty in kind of defining what Asian American art is now, because I feel like it has to be a global story. It can't just be about America. So that opens up this huge door. And I know we have to ask ourselves, well, what is it that we really do have in common? And if it's just the American side of us, is that what we want to celebrate? You know, I don't know, you know, considering what's been happening around the world. I certainly don't celebrate just the Japanese side of myself, because, you know, I'm not that thrilled about the Japanese, the history of Japan and its interactions in the world either. So. But given that, I feel like maybe I should go back to what, I'm sorry, what was your name?
Niall.
What you said about trying to come up with new images that are close to or touch on a common theme. I guess I have to start really with the kinds of themes that people want to see in their community that would represent how they feel about a place. And it might not be about race, you know, it might not, I have to assume that I would have to deal with some kind of history. And so I often use history as a base, because history is a timeline of change, and there's so much overlapping and shared histories that if you start from a historical point of view, or start with memories, or think about the past as a starting point, then it's very easy to kind of see how things come together. But whether or not people are going to step back and say, oh, that's Asian American art, I don't know.
It's to celebrate your uniqueness. That is to say that when you're young, when we're all young,
we're still young. That's my last name.
And that we were influenced to have certain beliefs those believe, what's unusual about you is those believe never left you. Time change, circumstance change, opportunity change, people, you know, change themselves, but you never change. Those who are difficult, I'm not saying very negative.
Thank you.
That the choices you make have certain very high social values. And those choices you make defines the kind of work you do, define the people that you work with, and that also define where, you know, that you are not going to be choosing the kind of success normal people think about. The period that, in the 1970s, there were basement workshops. There were these very politically conscious people. There were also all kinds of artists at that time, from Taiwan, from Hong Kong. They come to the United States to do modern art. Their success is about selling. Their success is about. So I think what I think is most unusual about you is that we need to celebrate you for the honest truth. All these decades you have followed, and that makes in the end your brand.
Okay, I get it now.
Thank you for giving us the branding tonight.
Thanks, Russell.